ready for move. Ready to take hammer three. Music cue. Get back to recordings. Taking house music down. And cue music. And now, streaming live from the Newman Library Athenaeum on the Blacksburg campus of Virginia Tech, it's Vox Humanities Conversations with your host, the director of the Center for Humanities at Virginia Tech, Dr. Sylvester Johnson.
I'm Sylvester Johnson, and this is Vox Humanities, a live streaming program from the Center for Humanities at Virginia Tech. As with all productions under the Vox Humanities Media imprint, the Conversations Initiative places its focus on advancing human-centered knowledge. We do this by engaging with experts whose work explores human life and human culture through a critical lens and that serves to enhance public understanding about the impact of social disparity in a complex world. What makes Conversations unique is an emphasis on sharing stories that connect us to the humanity within the humanities. For each episode, we invite one or more guests to open a window onto the story of the work that they're doing, both the story that stands behind their work and the story that lives within. Military service plays an incredibly broad role in our society, including in our educational institutions. Virginia Tech, in fact, is one of a small number of universities in the United States that has a corps of cadets. Among the many intersections that the military has with education is the role of humanities. The skills and knowledge that are integral to studying humanities are of tremendous importance for many professions. This is especially true for military service. Our guest today, Captain James McGrath, holds tremendous experience as a humanities expert and is a retired member of the U.S. military. His perspective into the relevance of humanities for our world today promises some important insights for our viewers. So welcome, Captain McGrath. We're so glad you could join us.
Thanks, Sylvester. I'm glad to be here.
All right. So tell us about your role and your work here at Virginia Tech.
Well, I'm the director of the Rice Center for Leader Development, and the primary role of the Rice Center is to focus on the educational aspects of our Corps of Cadet experience. We do that through a couple of different means. We offer some dedicated leadership classes for our cadets to talk about the specific attributes of developing global ethical leaders of character, which is the Corps' primary objective. We also do it by leveraging the vast amount of opportunities that we have here at Virginia Tech for education. We encourage our students to take a broad range of classes, as do the ROTC programs that are here supporting the officers who are going to be commissioned. And we have about 20% of our cadets who are going to go on to non-military careers. And so a number of them are also taking classes through the Corps of Cadets that help them focus on developing those career paths.
That's great. Well, you and I have had lots of conversations about the connections between humanities and military service. Can you tell us about one of the more challenging aspects of your work in the military that became for you an empowering learning experience?
I'm going to start with a quick anecdote about how you mentioned we've done that.
Yeah.
It was early on in COVID, and with our wives had both decided to go for a walk in the woods and mm-hmm. ran into each other on the path.
That's right. Jefferson National Forest.
Exactly. Right? And we just started chatting about something, and we just kind of kept clicking and clicking and clicking, and we're like, wow, we're talking about the same stuff. This sounds awesome. And I think that's kind of indicative of how the humanities is treated in some ways in the military. It's not the focus. Mm-hmm. And the focus more recently especially has been on technology. Mm-hmm. And because of that, there's been a very great focus on having officers especially mm-hmm. Who are educated in engineering and the sciences and computer sciences and other technologies. And I think the challenge though is we've forgotten sometimes that it's humans who serve in the military, and it's humans who operate that material. And I'm going to borrow from Clausewitz, the classic military, that but war is politics through other means. So the military, if and politics is about people. Mm-hmm. And so the intent of military action is to force someone to do something, to do what you want them to do through force. But it's at the end of the day, it's a cognitive process. And I think when we focus on technology, we forget about the people in the process. And recognizing that cognitive piece is what I've come to challenge. I think where that also comes into play is I get a lot of challenges with when I recommend that people take classes in humanities, in history, in philosophy, in ethics, they're downplayed because they're not seen as important. And I think that's the challenge that I have, is encouraging people not to ignore the technology, because that's there, but to also include the humanities in the process.
Yeah, no, you're right. There is a lot of focus on technology across our society. I imagine there are some particular reasons why the military is focusing on technology. But it is also true, I think, that it reflects a more general pattern in society as well, where technology receives a lot of focus, and there are questions around, well, what's the relevance? What's the connection between humanities and technology? But what do you think are some of the particular reasons why the military has, sounds like you're suggesting, more recently given a renewed focus on technology?
Well, I think there's a couple of things. There's an adage that the Army equips the man, and the Navy mans the equipment. Okay. So the Navy and the Air Force especially are very technology-heavy services. Okay. We don't go to sea in rowboats. There are massive, complex machines that we operate on, the airplanes, the ships, and everything that goes along with that. And so there has to be a level of technological competence to operate those massive pieces of technology. Mm-hmm. I think where the challenge becomes is the recognition that not everyone has to be a subject matter expert in every piece of the technology.
Okay.
Somebody still has to be able to employ that and figure out what the right use is. I think you and I have talked a little bit about the artificial intelligence space, and which has become a very prominent thing in the military recently. And I think with the advent of drones and more autonomous type vehicles, that's where the focus of a technology is, because there's a perception that if I use a drone, if I use a autonomous vehicle, that I'm putting our military personnel in a safer space. But I think that's the technology focus. But where we're, I think, lacking and is the how do you is what are the ethics of that? What are the right uses? Where there's a much greater challenge to make some of those ethical right or wrong decisions when the person is much removed from the situation. And I think that's where one of the reasons why we've seen a much greater emphasis on the technology. I think we also see technology, as you mentioned, flourishing in the whole world. And our potential adversaries are leveraging technology in many ways. And I think there's a fear very similar to the Sputnik situation in the 50s when our adversaries launched a satellite into space. There was a great fear that we were going to lose the technological race, and you know, we saw a huge emphasis in STEM around that time. I think we have a very similar situation now, but it's instead of a Sputnik the moment, it's drones and AI.
Now that's a really interesting point, because you're right, there were significant implications and consequences and benefits to educational institutions, particularly research universities, in the 50s and 60s and all the decades since then, because of that emphasis on ensuring that there were necessary STEM skills for people to develop the research advancements and innovations that would address the concerns about military threats from potential adversaries. And so you're right, there has been a lot of attention toward AI in that same way. And I think to your point, you were mentioning it's important for us to keep in mind the importance of a comprehensive education and of those humanities skills, even while we're trying to figure out the right directions with the technology. So ever since that conversation on the trail in Jefferson National Forest, you know, I've really admired the many ways, Jamie, that your career and your own awareness of the intersection of these things is really exemplifies such an important, compelling case for the role of humanities in many different areas professionally, including military service. Can you talk about your experiences as someone who started out, you studied humanities, you went into military service, the things that you experienced allowed you to gain an appreciation for those intersections? Can you give us some examples of how you came to understand the importance of those connections?
Yeah, so I came to Virginia Tech like many young students with the intention of being an engineer. Mm-hmm. I found out early on my freshman year that that's not where I wanted to put my focus, so I did graduate from here with a history degree. But then in the Navy, I went into the Navy nuclear power program, and okay. That shocked a lot of people. They said, oh my gosh, how does a history major go into the nuclear power program? Mm. And I think a recent study that I was reviewing and when I was talking about some of this, how we educate officers, was done by the Air Force, and it was identifying the need for STEM in the Air Force, and they actually identified a term called STEM cognizant. Okay. And that was, they defined it as individuals who had 32 hours of training in STEM fields but didn't necessarily have STEM degrees. And what I consider myself to be is a STEM cognizant individual. My focus and my passion is in history and in learning from history and in studying history and seeing how things were done in the past and how that might be able to make us do things or allow us to do things better in the future. Okay. But I do that with an understanding, not necessarily to the level of designing things, but an understanding of how nuclear power works, for instance, and how our weapon systems operate, and an understanding of those elements. And I think for me, that history background and then the STEM cognizance has allowed me to kind of operate in both worlds. Mm-hmm. Where I see, that's also allowed me to kind of encourage people to, if they have a passion in history, or if they have a passion in philosophy or ethics or those sorts of things, is it's okay to pursue those, whether it's through a degree program or just a curiosity. I think it makes for a more rounded officer, because as the further you get up in the military ranks, the more often you are making ethical or philosophical decisions than technical or engineering-based decisions.
Hmm. Yeah, no, that makes sense. That's fascinating. So you've spent a lot of time when you were in the Navy, a lot of your life was working on a ship. Mm-hmm. Most of us don't do that. Maybe we've gone on a cruise or something for 7 days, but have not just spent so much time. Can you tell us one or two things that you experienced as part of your career in the Navy?
Yeah, so a lot of people ask about, you know, how is it hard? It's hard to do the shipboard life, and I will be the first to admit that leaving my family for 6 months at a time was the hardest part of that process. Okay. And it was not fun, but it's something that we understood and we worked through. But there's actually a freedom in being in that situation. When I'm on a ship, I'm doing my job. Okay. I'm doing what I've trained to do. Mm-hmm. And the number of distractions are at a minimum. I'm not worried about getting home in time for a dental appointment or figuring out where I've got to go grocery shopping, because all that stuff's kind of built in. And we probably work longer days, but they don't feel like as long a days because it's all part of the rhythm. Okay. And for me, since that was what I wanted to do for a living, when I was on the ship and out doing things for the long periods of time, I was doing the job I had trained to do, and it was fun. Mm. I think the other element is you get to know the people around you, and so it's especially if you're on a ship that's got a good working team.
Yeah,
that aspect is amazing. Mm. So I've gotten to do some, I think, pretty cool things.
Yeah.
In that process, but really it's you can focus on doing your job without the distractions.
So if you could think of just one example of a time when you were confronted with some task or some challenge that was difficult, but you figured it out as part of the work that you were doing on a ship, and maybe even it was a great learning experience for you. Does anything stand out?
A couple things do. Yeah. The one that I'm most proud is probably not the right word, but I felt very good about is nuclear-powered ships have to do a certification every so many years, mm-hmm. and you can move that a little bit, but there's an absolute deadline that you can't go past.
Okay.
Normally, we try to do those inspections when the ship is kind of back here at home where things are going well, mm-hmm. but a ship I was on through various circumstances had to do that while they were on deployment mm-hmm. in the Arabian Sea, supporting military operations in Afghanistan, and we were told you couldn't do it. It can't be done. It's impossible. You'll be offline too long. But I started about a month before it was supposed to happen. I figured out the timelines. I figured out the how to string together enough off station time to do it safely. And okay. We executed it perfectly. And that was one of my. I felt a great deal of accomplishment that we were able to actually get through that whole process and prove to others that it could be done. So that was a combination of a whole bunch of things. I had to have the technical knowledge of what the systems could do, but right. I also, you know, was able to kind of just draw on my critical thinking abilities and the like. So that was a pretty cool moment.
And it is a nuclear ship, so it's sort of...
It was a nuclear aircraft carrier, as a matter of fact.
Important to make sure inspections are done.
Yeah, yeah.
Make sure things are actually working as they should.
Yeah, yeah. Exactly.
Wow. Yeah, no, I think that's, you know, there are several things about that. So one is you were actually being told, you said, that this was something that just couldn't happen, but you figured out how to do it anyway, that mm-hmm. sense of initiative. But also you were talking earlier about the fact that the kinds of decisions that have to get made so often in any context, I think this might be true, but certainly in the context of military service, they're complicated, people-oriented or decisions that are some kind of ethical problem-solving method or nature, and not so much always controlled by technical things. So that certainly sounds like one example.
Mm-hmm. It certainly does.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I think it's important that you were someone who was a humanities major, you went into military service and working on a nuclear ship, and you did so having first thought about, you said, studying engineering, and you ended up studying history mm-hmm. and had a very successful career in the military and now are here at Virginia Tech. So what would you say to someone who maybe they're considering what to study in college, or maybe they're on the hiring end in some profession, and this student might be thinking about, well, I know I want to work in an area that requires working with technical systems mm-hmm. or developing some level of expertise in a technical environment, and I'm really passionate about these societal things, but I don't think I could study those societal things and actually function in that technical context. You did. So what would you say to that person?
First part of this is a critique of our current university system, mm-hmm. not Virginia Tech, but writ large. And mm-hmm. actually, I think Virginia Tech is doing a lot of great things with some of their multidisciplinary majors mm-hmm. That didn't exist when I was here. There's a couple of majors that exist now, National Security Affairs, Foreign Affairs, for instance, which yes. is a bunch of things. That's probably where I would have ended up if that had existed when I was here.
Okay.
But the idea that that you have to choose one or the other, I think it's a false dichotomy.
Okay.
I think too many people think, I have to be an engineer, and engineers only do this. Mm-hmm. Now, as a history major, I had a little more flexibility in my academic schedule, but I took classes. I took a meteorology class my senior year. Mm. I forgot how much physics was in meteorology. So it was a lot harder than I thought it was going to be. But the point was, I was curious. So I took a class I was curious about. I think that would be my recommendation is, if you're an engineer and you're interested in social activities or social subjects, then take a class. I think we tend to be too rigid in the only way to learn is in a numbered class that gives me credit.
Okay.
Read a book.
Okay.
I'm working on a lesson plan right now for next semester on that whole idea of leaders read. General Mattis, who was the Secretary of Defense for a little while, was famous for having an exhaustive reading list that no one could keep up on. But the point is that he was constantly reading. Okay. Another man who really espouses that is Admiral Jim Stavridis. He actually has a book called The Leader's Bookshelf, and so it kind of lays out some ideas. And if you look on Admiral Stavridis' bookshelf, he's not reading Clausewitz and Mahan and military theorists. He's reading fiction. He's reading business books. He's reading, and just reading, I think, is a great way of exposing yourself to those things. And none of that costs. I mean, it costs the cost of a book, obviously, and some time, but it can be done in parallel with other activities. And I think that's there's nothing that limits. If you're willing to open a book, I don't think you have any limits on what you can learn.
Yeah, no, that intellectual curiosity and that breadth of thinking and that breadth of understanding is certainly important. It's something that is celebrated and we try to cultivate in humanities. But yeah, as you described, certainly has been celebrated and modeled by these important military leaders. Mm-hmm. You're leading this Rice Center that is developing leaders. And you talked about some of the things you're doing in the center, and you also mentioned the center's focus on developing leaders for a global context.
Yes.
Can you tell us about some of the things the center is doing to develop those skills for leading? And can you also say something about the significance of the global?
Well, some of it's baby steps. Mm-hmm. One of the things that we do ask all of our incoming cadets to do is we have them take a global competency assessment.
Okay.
And I'm not worried about your score. Mm-hmm. I just want you to be exposed to the idea that you need to know where you stand in that process.
Okay.
And the Corps as an organization encourages students to take advantage of opportunities for overseas. There are several programs that are funded, which is nice, through the military process. There's an Olmsted Scholar Program, which goes to a foreign country every year. There's another program called Project Go, which uses language expertise. So we have a number of students who are taking foreign languages, and they'll spend a semester or a winter term or a summer in a country that speaks that language. And so those are some opportunities there. The Corps also offers a global scholars program. Unfortunately, the numbers for that are limited to about 25 a year, but that's an opportunity where we spend some time looking at a historical event, and then we go to where that historical event happened and walk the ground and be there. So we've got those elements. I'd say that probably gets a very great exposure to maybe 20% of our cadets. But otherwise, we are continuing to encourage, overseas study opportunities. We work very closely with the Squires Cultural Centers to get our students engaged in the cultural activities that happen here on campus and the like. And so we may not necessarily get everyone out to some other country to experience the culture in person, but we very much try to build it into a lot of the elements of what we do every day.
Yeah. No, I think as I listen to you, it just occurs to me that there are so many ways the realm of military service doesn't even make sense without the global. it is already positioned to engage with the world in many levels in terms of infrastructure or where people are stationed if they're doing service. And of course, just understanding that, as you were talking about politics earlier, that politics is something that happens across different regions of the world, around different, between different populations. Mm-hmm. And so it is very much really already ingrained in the sense that you can't be focused only on your own nation or your own culture or society and be closed off to understanding the world. So I think it's really exciting to hear the work that the center is doing in that way. It's very compelling.
I'll also say, though, I think it's amazing sometimes. I had an opportunity to meet with naval officers particularly, but other services as well from a number of different countries. Mm-hmm. And I distinctly remember having a conversation with some Indian naval officers when we were doing an exercise with the Indian Navy, mm-hmm. and how much our conversation was about the same issues, problems, concerns, because we were both sailors. Mm. And the issues and concerns of sailors are universal. Now they had some specific elements that they had to deal with in their culture and their navy and their nation, but most of the things we were chatting about mm-hmm. were the same things mm-hmm. because they were issues that sailors have to deal with. Mm-hmm. So there's that was a beautiful explanation or a beautiful illustration for me of how much we have in common. Even when we might have many things that separate us.
Now that makes sense. Yeah, and I think being able to explore those and encounter those intersections was precisely because you were able to meet those people and mm-hmm. spend that time.
Yeah,
you know, it's really important and I think timely to think about some of these larger national conversations happening around technology and humanities. You mentioned at the very beginning of our conversation that there is strategic interest in cultivating new talent in technology. And you noted the parallel with, what was it, 70 years ago, or it's almost 70 years ago, mm-hmm. Or with Sputnik and the growth of AI. I think it's fair to say that in military applications, the use of autonomous technologies or algorithmic decision-making software that makes decisions, you can do it faster than a person can, than a human can, is becoming even more important. Hypersonic missiles, one of those things that there's a lot of conversation now that moves so quickly, a human can't make decisions to try to intervene in something like that, that there has to be automated decision making. And so I'm just fascinated to hear you talk about that because it is an important parallel. These conversations are happening, and they're happening alongside other conversations about what I would call comprehensive education. You know, what kind of skills should students be learning? Mm-hmm. And so I think one of the things I hear you saying, and I appreciate your emphasizing, is the value of maintaining a comprehensive approach as we're trying to figure out these issues. You know, one of the things I've thought about since I came to Virginia Tech is that this used to be Virginia Polytechnic Institute, mm-hmm. and it was in 1969. Virginia Tech became a comprehensive university, and that the rest of that name and State University mm-hmm. became part of, even though we usually refer to it as Virginia Tech. But that was a decision 12 years after Sputnik to move in the comprehensive direction, and it happened at a time that I think it's fair to say most higher ed institutions in the U.S., they were doing more STEM, or if not STEM only, then STEM mostly, and less in the comprehensive, and that trend has continued nationally, but at Virginia Tech, we've maintained that emphasis on comprehensiveness. So, you know, one question that I have for you is about the role of the Corps of Cadets as actually being part of that opportunity for comprehensive learning. Our university started off with this very early military history, and it became a comprehensive university, but so part of that comprehensiveness is still the presence of the Corps and the ability to do some of the things you described, that is developing these leadership skills. Can you say something as someone who served in the military, who studied humanities, whose very job and career benefited from having humanities education as a focus while you were also cultivating these skills? Can you say something about the continuing role that the Corps provides within the context of that university's larger comprehensive mission?
Absolutely. Military officers have to be good at two fundamental things in order to be officers. Okay. They have to be able to do their job. And that might be a supply person, so they have to understand supply chains mm-hmm. and budgeting and I'm going to use the word technical with a small t aspects of
sure.
their job.
Sure.
But they also have to be able to lead. Okay. And leading is about people.
Okay.
Where I think Virginia Tech as one of the six senior military colleges, as you mentioned at the outset of the show, and specifically a Virginia Tech's model of a corps of cadets within a larger civilian university, mm-hmm. I think sets our cadets up for success, especially early in their careers, in a way that's not achievable in many other places, because we have access to this wonderful university where our students are taking classes from world-class professors and are getting degrees that are recognized around the world for their excellence. At the same time, those students are living leadership roles and have an opportunity to exercise some of those leadership opportunities and fail and succeed, but in an environment where failure is okay. Mm. And so when they leave here, I think our students are better prepared to lead in the military because they have the technical, whatever that small T is, mm-hmm. And the leadership aspects, which are a little less definable. I can't necessarily give you an academic credit and course for all of that 4 years of experience, but when they get to their first job, whether that's in the military or in the civilian world, I think they are stepping into that world with an advantage over their peers because they have that great education, so they mm-hmm. have that advantage, mm-hmm. and then they also have the leadership experience, the opportunities to have led in an organization, so when they step into a new organization, it's not the first time they're asked to be doing leading people, leading things, leading teams. They've had that opportunity. I think they step into that first job, military or non-military, mm-hmm. with an advantage over their peers.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's so important. We're gonna allow any of those who are joining us live to send any questions that you might wanna ask before we're done. But I was wondering if you could reflect on one or two of the most important lessons that you think that you've gathered just from your own career, either in the military or your own work here at Virginia Tech since you've retired from the Navy. And how did those one or two lessons change you as a person?
I think one of the biggest things that I've learned is that I don't have all the answers. Okay. I think when I started in this process, I was one of those people who firmly believed that you did 4 years of high school, you graduated from high school, you went and got a Navy scholarship, I came here and did 4 years of college, mm-hmm. and that was the path. Mm-hmm. And I was gonna walk out of here with all the knowledge I had to have, and I was gonna walk into my first job, and I was gonna know everything I needed to do. I was disabused of that fairly quickly. Well, the other thing I've learned over time, again through some reading and through some experience, is that I don't have all the answers. I might have a lot of the answers, but I don't have all the answers. And there's also a pretty good chance that I might be the only person who has the answer for something. Mm-hmm. And likewise, anyone who I'm working with. And I think that realization for me, that's probably the biggest lesson I've learned in this process, okay. is you can go in with an idea, but there's somebody else who might have either a better idea or a way to make your idea better, and including them in that process is vital. So that's probably one of the things that I've learned there. The transition from military to academia is frequently described as a challenge.
Okay.
Military is a very results-oriented organization. Okay. I mean, it's you either succeed or you don't succeed. Mm-hmm. Academia is not defined so much by individual success because of what I talked about before. Failure is, we want to explore the edges. So sometimes you're going to fail, and sometimes you're going to succeed, and sometimes you're going to learn, and sometimes you're going to not learn. Mm-hmm. And so it's more about process. It's more about being iterative and learning things. And those don't always go together, right? If you're a results-oriented person and you come into an organization that's focused on learning and processing and those sorts of things. And so I've found that I actually am enjoying, in many cases, having that results-oriented mentality, mm-hmm. but allowing that to loosen up a little bit,
yeah,
and kind of let the process happen. And it's given me a lot of freedom to throw a whole bunch of ideas out there and see which ones take root and can move forward. So that's, for me, that's actually been a little bit more freeing than where I was in some of my more structured, this is how we have to get to the end result type things.
Yeah, no, that makes sense. There is a lot of process-oriented, you're right, and lots more flexibility because it's a learning environment, it's
exactly.
a teaching environment,
exactly.
right? You, as you said, I like your point about giving students the ability to have some experience where things don't work. Mm-hmm. You know, you learn from that failure and you're able to come back from it and mm-hmm. To regroup and to come at it again. And also, I think before we go, if you could share any of your insights with people across our society, mm-hmm. Whether it's in the military or whether it's higher education or people who are in policy, around the future of learning and the future of talent, mm-hmm. Particularly given the things you emphasized from the start of our conversation. Technology, particularly these digital technology systems that involve machines that can make decisions very quickly, often because we need them to, mm-hmm. Taking over more decisions and the ethical implications of that, that's just becoming much more central to how our entire world operates. Our military is no exception. In fact, as I said, I think if you look at some of the things happening in military applications, probably some of the more compelling scenarios for taking a really complex approach to this stuff. What would you say to those stakeholders about the future of talent, the future of learning, given where we are as a global society with technology and some of the benefits to be had from humanities?
This is something I said in the paper that you and I talked about, is I think the military, especially the Navy and the Air Force, mm-hmm. are very much focused on only funding students who are interested in STEM degrees. They do that with high school level programs. They do that with their scholarship programs. The Air Force and the Naval Academy are over 85% STEM degrees. And I think in the process, they are eliminating talent who could be great value to the process.
Okay.
Because not everyone has a Pythagorean brain mm-hmm. and is going to come in and do math at the level that you need to in order to progress in those worlds. But that doesn't mean they don't have value in the decision space that you're talking about. I heard it described once, I do not need to know how to make a watch mm-hmm. in order to tell time with a watch.
Right.
I do need to understand how the watch works mm-hmm. and I need to understand how other people are using that watch.
Okay.
But I don't need to be able to make the watch in order to tell time.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the military has swung a little bit towards only having watch makers
okay.
and not necessarily having watch users. And that's my challenge there. A personal experience, I was in charge of a ballistic missile defense organization. I'm not a rocket scientist. Mm-hmm. We've already talked about that. I've got a history degree. But I was able to sit down with the scientists and understand enough about the process
mm-hmm.
to know how to, so I had the details on the process, so I knew what the limitations were, what couldn't be done. I could talk intelligently about ideas of how we might employ the system,
yeah.
and I could be in the conversation.
Mm-hmm.
And then the engineer might go back and tweak the computer program to change something, and that was not my job, but my job was to identify what, hey, it needs to be able to do this, or if it can't do that, then we have to do this other thing.
Mm-hmm.
And I think we've talked about this before, if it's the only people in the room are technicians,
mm-hmm.
everyone's going to look for a technical solution to whatever the problem is.
Okay.
When you've got technicians and non-technicians and a broader viewpoints in the room,
mm-hmm.
you're going to find broader solutions or more creative solutions.
Hmm. I am personally reassured that there was someone with a history background in that room who's in conversations about ballistic missiles. Yeah, there's lots to learn. Now, I think that's a really, really excellent illustration. It's great. Jamie, thank you so much for joining
us
for our conversation. It's been great to talk with you. Before it looks like we do have one question before we go from a viewer. So this viewer is saying, I like the idea of STEM cognizance. And they're asking, could this idea specifically include AI cognizant students who are trained to manage AI systems without themselves necessarily being coders, such as machine learning coders?
I think absolutely. And I was wrong to not mention this earlier. One of our partners with the Rice Center is the Hume Center and the new National Security Institute here at Virginia Tech. And I love working with that team because although they're doing a lot of technical things, they are deliberate about bringing non-technical people into those working groups. Okay. Now, sometimes it's logistics, sometimes it's policy, but they're deliberate about that. And I think absolutely with things like the Hume Center here at Virginia Tech, there's a great opportunity for people who are working, say, as a philosophy, even if they're, let's use philosophy as a, I'm working on a philosophy degree. There's nothing that says I can't be working on the philosophy of AI and take the necessary or, you know, structure the necessary courses that I would put those, that knowledge or the understanding of the system and how the system works into those philosophy courses. I think that would be a great idea.
That's great. Now that makes a lot of sense. Just want to make sure we don't have any other questions from our viewers. I was a little bit too quick on the draw. Are there any other final thoughts you might want to leave with our viewers before we go?
Yeah, I mentioned earlier that I have a lot of quotes from military officers, and one of my heroes is Admiral Grace Hopper. And if you want to talk to someone who's totally in the technology world, it's Grace Hopper. She was early in the computers in World War II era, and she stayed in the Navy for 40 years. She actually is the person who invented the term debugging when she found a moth in the computer.
Okay.
She wrote almost single-handedly the COBOL language. But one of my favorite quotes from Grace Hopper is that you manage things and you lead people. And we've spent too much time focusing on the management and forgotten about the leadership. And the last part of that quote is we should run all the MBAs out of Washington. But the focus part is you manage things and you lead people.
Okay.
And if you're not thinking about people, you're not thinking about leading.
That's a great note to end on. Well, thanks very much, Captain James McGrath, for joining us for another episode of Vox Humanities Conversations. We want to thank our viewers as well and remind you that Vox Humanities has a podcast that you can listen to anywhere you listen to podcasts. We want to encourage you to see the other content that is on our YouTube channel and appreciate all the engagement that we've gotten. And please join us for a future episode of Vox Humanities Conversations. Thank you very much. Thank you.